In the beginning of 2 Corinthians 5:20, it says that we are therefore Christ's ambassadors. Does this mean we are to represent the Lord wherever we are in the world? What about the entertainment industry? Does God have representatives in this industry? Is there a move of God to reclaim arts and entertainment for His glory? On today's program, our guests working in the industry of entertainment will share their stories and how they represent Christ. Welcome to Everlasting Love. I hope that you enjoyed our musical selection at the beginning of the program. My name is Lisa Rogers, and I will be your host for this evening. We here at Everlasting Love really just want you to know that God loves you, that He loves you with an everlasting love, that you haven't traveled too far away from Him, that He still loves you and He wants to talk to you. He is only a prayer away. So we want to be a resource and a help to you. If you need someone to pray with you, if you need someone to read the Bible with, to help you find a church, please don't hesitate to call us at 773-286-2171. We also have a website, www.everlastinglovetv.com. You can contact us that way also. And also, if you miss a show or want to see other shows we've done or just have more questions about things, you can check out our YouTube page also, and you can just see the various other things that we've done on there. Today, I have a great treat for you. We're talking about Christ in the entertainment industry. It's so exciting. Is he reclaiming it? We see more and more faith-based movies. Like, what is going on? What is God doing? And today I have with me three real live actors and directors and people in the entertainment industry. And I really feel a little starstruck, you know, like they've, you know, been acting and like, I want to do that. It just seems like so much fun. So I want to share with you my panel. I have Vincent Shade, who is a director. He's kind of a little like Hitchcock, mm-hmm. in that he started in production and then he became a first AD, and now he is his own director. Mm-hmm. And currently he is working on a movie, a short called 72 Hours.
Actually, 72 Hours is a feature film.
I apologize. Yeah. It is a feature film. Yeah. We also have with us Ms. Mimi Sagadin. So exciting. She was a co-founder of Mission Improvable, and she's also currently starring as Corrie Ten Boom in Return to the Hiding Place. And we also have Miss Amy Newbold. Did I say that correctly?
You got it, girl.
Oh, yep. Good. Yes, yes. Okay. We have Miss Amy Newbold, who is currently starring as Molly in the hit movie Divergent. Mm. Yes. So this is so exciting. Yeah, because that's right, like in theaters. My dad saw it. He loved it. So I'm sure he loved
you.
Oh,
God, I'm glad. I don't know. I don't play a very nice girl, but
maybe I'm sure that acting was wonderful because he believed it all. So I think it's great.
Awesome. I'll take it. I will take it. Thank you.
Okay. We love to start the show just learning a little bit about you guys and learning how you came to Christ and like what he means to you and stuff like that. So Amy, would you start and tell us about your journey to faith?
Yeah, wow. Well, I grew up in Spokane, Washington in a home. My parents were always believers in Jesus, followers of the Lord, and I went to a church that was really solid growing up. Mm-hmm. But I didn't come to know and follow the Lord until I was about 17 years old. I have always had sort of this desire for greatness in my life. Like, I can remember from a very young age wanting to be very impressive to people and wanting for people to think that I was really something special. And so when I was growing up, that manifested itself in storytelling. I used to make things up a lot as a child.
Did you get in trouble?
Oh, my word. So much trouble. And when you're a little kid, I think there's something about it where it's frustrating for your parents. You know, it's funny. Sin is just so present in all of us. And I think it's very clear in those moments where you are a child who tells fibs. But as I grew older, it continued to be an issue for me. And because it was like this gnawing need for me to just be great, be impressive, no matter what lengths I had to go to. And so it sort of followed me into middle school, and it was about seventh grade when the Lord brought theater into my life, and I think that was his way of giving me a way of differentiating between what was real and what wasn't, being able to escape into something kind of fantastic and then be able to come back to reality. And so that's the beginning of when I can see his really hot pursuit of my heart, you know. He started to sort of break me of that need for to be great on my own.
Right.
And so, but it wasn't, like I said, until I was about 17 that it became clear to me that, you know, just through a series of events in my life that the Lord used to just break me down, bring me before him, and make me realize that there's nothing in me that is good, you know, apart from God, and that he is the source of all greatness, you know, and beauty, and I was just very aware. I remember a particular night, my senior year of high school, just being very, very aware of my own separation from God mm-hmm. and my own desperate seeking to be something really amazing. And I just was constantly falling short, mm-hmm. constantly feeling like a disappointment. And I just remember in that night also feeling at the same time sort of this weight of grace, this sort of release that, mm-hmm. you know, I had heard about Jesus my whole life and
right.
Growing up in that church. So that was the first time, though, where I felt he was for me mm-hmm. And that he was my greatness, if that makes sense. That
yeah.
on my own, I cannot be great, but through the work of Christ on the cross. I don't mm-hmm. know. In that moment, I just sort of felt that. So that was the turning point in my life. And I would say, you know, I didn't hand, as with most people, I didn't hand my life fully over to the Lord right in that right. moment. It was a slow turn and follow him, mm-hmm. learning how to do it every day. And
right.
That'll continue forever, exactly. as we all know. Right. So, but yeah, I moved to Chicago that same year. I had just come to know the Lord when I was 17, and I had already decided to go to school for theater in a great big city that I didn't know.
Wow.
And so God's just really been faithful in providing me with a church community and fellowship, and he just has always been constantly after my heart. So it's a miracle that I moved to Chicago at 17, just coming to know Jesus, and God has just provided so perfectly for me everything I needed to be able to continue to walk with him. So yeah, and now here I am. I went to school for theater. Did casting for a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Decided to go back to school for nursing.
Wow. You do a lot.
I know. I have sort of varied interests. I think something I've noticed since I've come to know the Lord is he has continued to use the circumstances of my life to kill that desire for greatness, because it's still there.
Right.
To bring me low so that he can be brought high in my life, you know?
Right, right.
And so I think looking back all of this series of events, I can see his hand in that, you know, just continually reminding me that my fulfillment, my identity is in the Lord and not in how the world sees me,
right.
Not how impressed the world is by me. So that's been a learning process through casting, through nursing, through Divergent,
right.
all of it. It's been that God is great, and I've been saved by him, and that's just kind of remarkable.
Yeah.
So I think it's a story worth telling.
I agree. I think that's something everyone goes to and we can all relate to on some level. You want to be the star, even if you don't want to be a singer or an actor, you want the credit.
Well, we
want
to matter, you
right.
know?
Right.
We want to be important, and
right.
We want to be valued. And I think, you know, it's always a struggle of where do I find that? Where do I seek that? And
right.
the world is here. We can see it. We can feel it. We can experience it. And so that's tempting, you know, to find our mm-hmm. identity and our validation in the world. And so I think everyone struggles with that, but the reality is there's no validation, no identity to be found
apart from
that
him.
Can surpass, or yeah, or apart from the Lord, from
yeah.
Christ. So, yeah, that's been my lesson, ongoing. I think so.
Yeah, I think it's everybody's kind of ongoing lesson. Mimi, can you relate to Amy at all in some of her story and share some of yours with us? Also,
oh, absolutely. I can relate to, you know, the greatness, wanting to be validated. That's
right.
And I came to know the Lord when I was in barber school. I'm actually a licensed barber, where I went to school to cut men's
really?
Hair and learn how to straight razor
wow.
shave.
Wow.
And it was like 1979, and when I was attending school, there was a book by Hale Lindsey that was made into a movie called The Late Great Planet Earth, and it was about Bible prophecy and
okay.
things that were coming to fruition in our time, and I was just really mm-hmm. interested in Bible prophecy, and I had mm-hmm. never read the Bible. I was brought up Catholic, and I thought it was fascinating.
You didn't read the Bible?
Not being brought up Catholic.
Okay.
It wasn't a practice that we did at that time. It was
okay.
more like I'm Italian and I'm Catholic, you know? And
okay.
so I knew, I always believed in God, and I always had the question of, well, why are there so many different religions? You know,
right,
I always
right.
knew that there had to be one truth. So mm-hmm. that prompted me to investigate a little bit more, and a good friend that was attending barber school at the time.
Mm-hmm.
She was a Christian, and she shared with me that you can know that you're going to heaven. I wanted to know. I
mm-hmm.
wanted to know that I was going to heaven, because mm-hmm. I didn't know.
Right.
And she just shared that, you know, Jesus is alive. He rose from the dead. He really did die on the cross for your sins, and
right.
you can be forgiven. And
mm-hmm.
it resonated with me. And she said, all you need to do is pray that prayer. pray, you know, for him to be your savior.
Right.
And I went home and I did. And like you said, it wasn't an overnight thing. Mm-hmm. You just don't change overnight. But
right.
I just had the Holy Spirit in me, and I just had the desire then to grow in the knowledge of the Lord. And I found a Bible-believing church and started to attend there, and you know, little by little, grow my faith. And it was a process.
Yeah.
But I knew that I had this assurance that Jesus was real and that I was His, and just continue to grow in that. And you know, here I am, 1,000 years later.
Oh. It's not 1,000 years.
Yeah. Okay, 500.
Yeah. Well, the Bible says one day is 1,000 years.
That's right.
Years,
the That's Lord, right.
1,000 years
That's
is one day. So I like to take the one day part.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
Like, so it's just really like a couple days. You're really just
it's been
like
a long journey, but I'm grateful. I know I've been serving the Lord for over 35 years, and
oh wow,
I'm just I'm amazed at, you know, what He's done in my life to give me the validation that I wanted and sought as a little girl too, and through my acting, and I'll share that with you later. But
so you felt like as a child you needed validation or attention or more than what
I wanted to be an actor ever since I could remember too. I liked performing. I liked to make people laugh. Mm-hmm. I liked to stare at myself in the mirror. My family always teases me. So now I really get to hear those stories from when I was 3 and would cry, you know, in the mirror and just look at myself.
What did you say to yourself?
Oh, I just cried. I just wanted to look at myself crying. You know, I was just.
I totally know what you're saying. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
You.
You know too, right?
Oh,
okay.
Of course.
But I think we're made, you know, we're made to have this void. We have this God-shaped void in us.
Right.
And so we often go towards validation or work or something to fulfill us.
Right.
You know, and it's only the Lord that fulfills us. So I think we all go through that in certain ways individually.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Vince, how about you? Did you cry in the mirror as a child and just want to watch yourself cry?
I don't think so. I didn't really cry in the mirror so much. But you know, growing up for me was a little difficult. You know, I had a divorced family.
Okay.
Or, you know, young enough to remember. Mm. And then I was talking earlier to Amy, and both my parents are pilots. My mother and my stepfather. So they traveled us around all over the place all the time. So a lot of great experience, you know, a lot of great people. But that got me used to starting over again.
Okay.
Constantly reinventing myself to a point where I kind of couldn't identify with myself at all.
Okay.
Led to a lot of rebellious phases, and I got into trouble quite a bit when I was younger. I disrespected my parents a lot, so I got sent to military school. You know, it's one of those things where you say, you know, oh, what are you going to do, Mom? Send me to military school? And you know, a week later, there you are. So I was in military school from kind of my younger teenage years all the way up till 18.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't have a whole lot of contact with anybody else. But the school itself was Episcopalian.
Oh, okay.
And even though I'm Roman Catholic and I was raised Catholic and everything else, they taught us the Bible very strictly. So we studied it, and I had a great knowledge of the Bible by the time I had left the school. But I didn't have an appreciation for the words.
Okay.
You know, that's the thing. The Bible never changes.
No.
But you do, you know. Right. So you can go back to these passages. You know, it's miraculous sometimes, you know. You just flip through it, and you find something that applies exactly to what you're thinking about.
Right.
You know, and it speaks to you sometimes, you know, in that way.
And
so when I left military school, I found that I was a little bit like Saul.
Okay.
I had a great need for a cathartic opposite that I had projected throughout my whole life. This rebellious, mean kind of, you know, anger-filled person.
Mm-hmm.
I had wanted to change. I had wanted to seek out opportunities to help people.
Mm-hmm.
And at first it was all for redemption.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, there's this passage that says, you know, man will not know happiness until he has served. And as soon as I started serving the Lord, it was like everything opened up. It was like everything opened up, and I had the hardest time because I tried to serve the community at first. I joined the police academy, and I had almost all my credits, and then I got into this car accident. And in the state of Michigan, you can't get into the police academy unless you have a flawless driver's record. So I went to my second love, which is food. I love food, but I love the culinary arts.
Too. Yeah, me too.
I mean, who doesn't, right? It's fantastic. So I was, I was a chef for a while, and I
really
worked at Schoolcraft Community College. They have a really good culinary arts program.
Wow!
But they also have a really good film program.
Okay.
And my whole life I've loved movies.
Right.
And
right.
During this whole phase of my life, I am constantly helping out in movies for free.
Yeah.
I started out in craft service, so started helping out and just for free because I just wanted to be on sets and meet people and things, and it became so addicting.
Right.
So then I went to a school that had was faith based, and I made sure that I got a degree. But when I started working in the industry, I found that the secular nature of it was taking over.
Mm.
And it's really scary.
Mm-hmm.
So I always try to include faith-based messages and show that kindness is the best way to lead.
Yeah.
And ever since then, ever since I've been committed to God after military school, so right around 18, 19 years old, it's been nothing but success for me. I felt very, very blessed.
So you went to yes, to yes, to yes.
Yeah, every time. It was great. It was great. Every single time, God showed me a path, and I just trusted Him. I used to have this poster in my room, do your best, and God will do the rest.
And that's been true for you?
It's been true for me, absolutely.
Oh, wow. Yeah. It's so exciting to meet people who have stories of faith and redemption and things like that, and that there really is a reward to serving God. Because I think so many times you see in life or movies where people try to tell you that there is no reward. You know, you're just doing this for no reason, but you're not, because He is there and He's with you in life. Well, thank you guys so much for sharing your stories of faith. That was just like really great to hear that. Okay, I have a question for you, Vincent. So
for sure.
You are a director, but you're also a first assistant director. Can you explain that to the audience? Like, what does that mean?
Okay.
And how you do that?
Please do.
Absolutely. So a director focuses on actors and the shot.
Right.
And then assistant director focuses on everything else.
Okay.
So every other element to the filmmaking process, an assistant director manages.
Okay.
I use the word manages, not control.
Okay.
There are two different styles of an assistant director, and those that create kind of a fear-based environment, which is a lot of yelling, a lot of deadlines, and a lot of strict results.
Right.
You know, you don't do this, you're fired, that sort of thing.
Okay.
But because I come from where I come from,
right,
and I've seen the struggles that people have done, and I fuse so much of Christ and God and the Bible in what I say to people, I have a knack for a lot of people to call me back and a lot of people to hire me again and again because they say, you create an environment of love where everybody respects each other, where everybody talks to each other politely. I always say the two P's, keep it polite, keep it professional. And it's a very honest working environment.
Mm-hmm.
Where everyone can work calmly and efficiently.
Right.
And the other thing is that I love movies. So
right.
I've done every single job.
Mm-hmm.
So I can speak to a makeup artist about how long it takes spirit gum to dry on a fake mustache. And I can do certain things like that to speak their language and to understand, you know, how long a lens swap takes or how long a battery takes to, you know, reboot a Red One camera or something like that. But the point is that I respect everybody's job, and I respect them as people, and I always try to fuse that in because, you know, starting out in the film industry, I was, you know, as a lot of people are, they're abused, you know, their time is abused, them as people is demeaned,
right,
and that's hard. So I try to create an environment of love where everyone can feel like they can enjoy themselves, enjoy their work, and work efficiently together.
Kind of like servant leadership.
That's exactly right.
Christ as the model.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. Do unto others is a huge thing that I always say. And then I also never ask someone to do something that I'm not willing to do myself. First day, I take out all the trash. And I show everybody that, you know, this is where it goes, this is how it goes, and I do that. Not like I've not taken out trash before, but it's important for them to understand that I'm willing to be where they are.
Right.
You know, Jesus said when sitting at a table, one always sits at the end. You know, that way you can only move up chairs.
Right, right.
You know, and it's important also to speak in a way that is empathetic.
Right.
Towards everybody else and their situation. Mm-hmm. You don't know what everyone is going through. And
so true.
So I respect that. And so, you know, I as a result, you know, God has put me in places and given me opportunities that reward this type of leadership.
Mm-hmm.
There are so many people out there in the film industry that don't operate this way.
Right.
Because they're scared of that, oh, if I'm really nice to someone, they're not going to listen to me. But I have faith. I have faith in not only God, but God teaches us to have faith in other people and to trust them with their job and with their word. And, you know, how can I, you know, ask someone to trust me if I don't trust them? So I extend the olive branch, and I've seen nothing but successful results.
Right.
And it's such a rewarding feeling for me to walk around and see people helping other people. Instead of people looking at the clock, wondering how much they're getting paid, or, you know, just nitpicking on everything, you know, because that doesn't exist on my sets.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody is just is in a friendly, happy, and it's an environment of love and care.
Okay, guys, this one's for picture again. For picture, camera, are we set?
Set.
Sound is set. Roll sound, please.
Sound speed.
Roll camera.
Camera speed.
Scene B2, take one. Sound F11.
And action.
Has anyone ever told you that the way you ran your sets changed how they decided to run theirs later, or how they interacted with people?
Yes. As a matter of fact, a lot of people, since I'm in the indie film world, since I love working with new people and people that haven't don't necessarily have a lot of experience, they're looking for assistance, looking for help, and I love to help people that need help.
Right.
They say, I had no idea it could be done this way. I had no idea it can be accomplished this way.
Wow.
And people stress out, they yell, they scream, they get frustrated. Because filmmaking is a stressful time.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of machine parts working at the same time.
Right.
But if properly prepared and if appropriately motivated, there's no reason why we can't be nice to each other.
Next, we have Miss Mimi, and she has a feature film called Return to the Hiding Place, where she plays the amazing Miss Corrie Ten Boom. We're going to just take a second and watch the trailer for that.
I'm glad I wasn't in the shop yesterday.
Did the Gestapo come?
They were the soldiers.
Did they ask you about sheltering Jews?
Thankfully, no. I'm so torn as to what to say. God says to never lie, yet I must be truthful of us.
But wait a minute. What do you mean, thankfully, no? You're not saying that if they had asked you if you were sheltering Jews, you would have betrayed your Jews? You would have betrayed human life to save your mouth from being soiled by a lie?
Please, you see. Sit down. Let's talk.
Talk about it? We're talking about human lives here, and you just want to talk?
Shh. People in the streets are looking up at you.
She was only saying that she didn't want to lie.
Surely, as a Jew, you know the ninth commandment. Thou shalt not bear false witness.
Children, please, the ultimate law is to obey the law of God, not that of man.
Exactly! Have you ever been afraid? I mean, really afraid. Afraid for your life? No, of course you haven't. You weren't in that house in Amsterdam where the people chose to kill themselves rather than relive the horror of returning to Germany. And I would lie, I would steal, and I would kill to save those lives.
Well, that is where you and I disagree.
Really? Did not the great-grandmother of your Messiah, Rahab, lie to save the spies in Jericho? the mother of Moses. The midwives, did not they lie to save the Hebrew babies? And what does the Bible say? They were blessed by God. Beware of your selective morality. It is a dangerous pursuit.
You see, they are only trying to obey God. I understand you're upset, but please, show the Ten Boom some respect. They are, after all, endangering their lives for you.
Corrie and Betsy, you'll lie to the Germans every day. You have stolen ration cards under your floorboards. You have a forbidden radio receiver. You have forged documents flying all over the place. How do you rationalize those lies? Look, all I'm asking you is whatever you do, just apply those simple rationalizations to save the lives of us Yids. I must have your answer now.
Today, we vow to be Rahab and the midwives. Whatever befalls you, may it also befall us as well.
You must give him a word, Corrie. He's right. Saving lives is our first concern. It's time we turn this house into a safe house.
Mimi, how did you get this role? I know that you did it in the theater first. How did it come about on the big screen?
It started because I was cast graciously by a lady that you worked with, Becca McCracken, in The Hiding Place for a minor role in that play at Provision Theater here in Chicago.
Oh, okay.
And I played a concentration camp prisoner in a 3-hour play, and but got to work with all these equity actors, which was amazing. It was my first equity production. And
what is equity? Can you
equity
tell our
is the
audience?
Actors union for theaters.
Oh, okay.
For theater actors. Mm-hmm. So productions that are equity are, you know, finer productions. Mm-hmm. And it's just a real honor to be involved in that
right.
kind of a production. And it's hard to get in to a union film or a union theater if you aren't union. So
right,
it's kind of a catch
right.
22.
Yeah. Right.
So I got cast in that. Tim Gregory is the director and the founder of Provision Theater.
Okay.
And it was an amazing play based on the story by Corrie Ten Boom.
Mm-hmm.
And interestingly, you know, by a divine coincidence, the return of The Hiding Place was in pre-production in Texas from a company by the name of Spencer Productions. One of the actresses had heard about the film and contacted them, letting them know, hey, we've got 30 actors in Chicago that are
right.
ingrained in the story for 3 months. We had dialect training. And
oh, wow.
Would you be interested in auditioning them? And they were, you know, of course interested. So I auditioned thinking that I would just be happy to get a role as a statue in the corner somewhere, you know. And lo and behold, I got cast as Corrie Ten Boom. I didn't play
wow.
her in The Hiding Place.
Mm-hmm.
I had a minor role.
Okay.
But the Lord
worked it
saw
out.
To it that I was cast as this amazing Christian giant. And it was such an honor because for 23 years I've been praying that verse that you said at the beginning of the show, being an ambassador for Christ. That's been my calling in film. And for 23 years, myself and other people that are involved in the arts as Christians, we've been praying that God would reclaim the arts for Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so to get offered this role was, it was about as close as being in the presence of the Lord as I've ever been in my life.
Wow.
Because it was a calling that I knew that the Lord had called me to. It was a desire that I had when
child.
I was crying, you know, in the mirror as a 3-year-old. Mm-hmm. And for the Lord to bring this together
right.
for Him, it was just mind-blowing. I mean, I really felt like I was Moses in front of the burning bush when I received that call. And I continue to feel that with the many things that occurred, you know, with the casting. And so I got cast as Corrie, and we filmed.
Just to interrupt you real quick, I know that some people might not know the story
sure.
of Corrie. Could you just give us a quick synopsis
of what
that is?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, Corrie Ten Boom wrote a book called The Hiding Place back in the 70s, and she is a woman that is a Dutch woman that during World War II, when Hitler was invading Holland, she and her sister and father hid over 800 Jews in their home. And how they did that was, is their home was a safe house, and they would hide them in this hiding place that was a false wall in her bedroom that they made. And so it was about her hiding these Jews in her home during that time. Return to the Hiding Place is a sequel of sorts to that story. It was a Billy Graham production, actually, back in the 70s. So Return to the Hiding Place, instead of it being Corrie Ten Boom's point of view, it's the teenager's point of view, which I really love. She had an underground army of teenagers that really a lot of people don't know about. They were called the Rolls Royce and the Dutch Resistance, that were made up of untrained teenagers that had great faith, that wanted to help protect these innocent Jewish families. Right. And so they helped Corrie Ten Boom do that. So people would come to her home, and she would hide them for a few days, and then these teenagers would take them to different farms and different safe houses throughout Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. And she hid over 880 Jews during that time.
Wow, that's amazing.
But in The Hiding Place, the original story, they show you where her family is caught and then sent to concentration camp. Corrie Ten Boom survived miraculously, and for 35 years she traveled the world telling her story of forgiveness, because she ended up having to forgive the people that captured her. And so it's just a really great story of faith, and Return to the Hiding Place focuses on the teenagers that were willing to stand up against Hitler and to go against the tide of political correctness. It's pretty amazing.
Wow. How was it working on this project?
It was life-changing. It was to be immersed in a true story of people willing to lay down their life. They laid down their life for a friend and for strangers.
Right.
So to be involved in a true story like that, it challenged my faith, you know, as to what would I do in uncertain times? What will I do?
That's a good question.
We live in very interesting times, and our faith needs to grow and be strong, and so it just challenged me to just grow in my faith in the Lord and just live for Him daily, and just share my faith, you know, with people around me.
It's playing right now, right? Can
so
you tell people today, how they can?
Actually, we have had a limited theatrical release in 5 cities that began last week Friday. Today's the end of the week, so there's one more showing today. But and it's been successful. We had sold out screenings. Really positive response. It's a really beautifully shot movie. I'm just so honored to work with just such a great production company, Spencer Productions. It's a family. It's a father and a mother. The father, mother, and the four children.
Oh wow!
That were involved. And Peter Spencer, this story of Return to the Hiding Place is based on the book of the same name by Hans Pole, and he was the first person that Corrie Ten Boom hid at her home. So Hans Pole, even though he wasn't Jewish, he did not want to join Hitler's army, so he had to hide in the Ten Boom's home. He wrote this book, and my producer, director, got to know him through a chain of events, and for 17 years they had this wonderful friendship. And so Hans shared all these miraculous stories that occurred in Corrie's home, and my director Peter he'd check, you know, archives to make sure that all these stories were true, and they were.
Wow.
And so it was just a great labor of love that this family produced this film, and he's got so many wonderful stories that he actually is, you know, writing this book about the miracles of Return to the Hiding Place. It's just a really interesting story. So getting back to the release, we're having a wide release in September.
Well, Amy, I know that you have a new movie also called Divergent.
Divergent.
Yes, it's an exciting thriller. So we're going to take a quick peek at Amy's new movie, Divergent. You're going to see the trailer right here.
Thank you. you nervous?
Were you? For your test?
No. I was terrified.
The only way our society can survive is for each of you to claim your rightful place. Today, you will take a test that will help you discover who you truly are. The future belongs to those who know where they belong. You ready?
Results were inconclusive.
This was supposed to tell me what to do. We're supposed to trust the test.
The test didn't work on you. They call it divergent. You can't let them find out about you. They're always watching. You have to hide, or they'd never expect to find you.
Welcome to Dauntless.
With two stages of training. First is physical. Push your bodies to the breaking point.
You're never gonna win, not like that.
It's good to know.
Keep tension here, okay?
The second is mental. Face your worst fears and conquer them.
You made a mistake choosing Dauntless. We'll find out about you.
I know what you are.
It's been a long time since I could trust anyone.
I don't want to be just one thing. I want to be brave. And selfless and intelligent and honest and kind. If you want to survive, follow me.
Divergents threaten the system. It won't be safe until they're removed.
We have to fight back.
Ready.
Amy, how was it working on this movie?
It was crazy. It was so fun and a completely unexpected blessing. So I was totally overwhelmed, and it's just, I mean, I'm still kind of reeling a little bit. I'm on the tail end of everything, so I'm still kind of processing. But I mean, it's crazy. It was my first film. I've never been on a film set, and it's huge budget movie. I mean, it was totally overwhelming. So. But in the best possible way.
Yeah.
You know?
How did you get the role? How did that happen?
God just sort of orchestrated this crazy chain of events, you know? I graduated from school in 2008, which is like the world's worst job market.
And yes, 2009 crash.
I didn't know what I was going to do. I had been focusing on casting for my last 2 years of school.
Mm-hmm.
I had made a decision going into my junior year that I didn't really want to make a career at acting, so I had a casting director for a professor at the time, Jane Alderman, and just sort of glommed onto her, and she was very gracious and mentored me my last 2 years. So she got me an internship at Claire Simon Casting the fall after I graduated, and the Lord just so graciously provided a job for me right after my internship. It was against all odds. He worked a huge miracle, and at the time, television and film were starting to kind of ramp up in Chicago, and so I was working on projects that no 22-year-old has any business working on. It was just amazing. I was assisting on Detroit 187 for ABC and Chicago Code for Fox, Contagion, and Man of Steel, just jobs that someone with as little experience as I had, I mean, that just really, again, worked it out so that I could learn from the best very quickly.
Right.
Learn the industry, learn how the audition process works and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And then at the same time, in November 2009, I took a trip to Istanbul with my church, and the Lord started to kind of open my eyes to cross-cultural ministry, specifically with Muslims, and sort of building bridges that have been broken by hurt, by the ways that Muslims have been hurt by the church and vice versa.
Right.
And so I started to kind of get intrigued by that. The Lord sort of grabbed my heart in that way. And then I came back to Chicago, and he just, again, through a series of events, dropped cross-cultural ministry in my lap. I was working on a film for the Wachowskis, who did the Matrix movies, where my primary job was to interview Iraqi refugees
And so, and at the time, we also had an intern in the office who was a Muslim as well. And it was just a culture I didn't know all that much about.
Right,
and
right.
God just continued to put people in my life to care for and love on and learn from,
right.
as far as what developing relationships and relational ministry looks like,
right.
cross-culturally. And from that, I thought, oh, I want to go overseas and do ministry. And the Lord put in my mind that maybe nursing was the way to do that. So I left my job in casting.
Wow.
to go back to school for nursing, just because I felt like that would be a step of obedience, not knowing that the Lord would use nursing school as a tool to kind of push me back into the arts.
Oh, wow.
Because I was going to school, was now freed up to audition for projects, because you can't do that when you're a casting director. It's very taboo.
Oh, okay.
While I was in nursing school, was auditioning for little day player parts on TV shows, mm-hmm. And miraculously was booking them. And
wow.
Then my former boss, Claire, this script for Divergent came across her desk, and I mean, God just, he made this role, physically at least. I mean, it's this girl who's tall, big, can fight, you know? It's like,
could you fight before?
I had no fighting experience, okay. but I am 6'1", and there's, you know, a lot of times as a girl, you write yourself off a little bit in
right.
film and television once you reach a certain height. And God just really proved me wrong in that way. He gave me this perfect part. So I went in and auditioned, and we just sent my tape away. That's usually how it happens in
right.
Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't hear anything for like a month. And then Neil, the director, came to Chicago and said he really wanted to meet with me. And so
oh,
I
wow.
met with him, and then like 2 days later, I got the part. So.
How long do we fight for?
Till one of you can't continue.
Or one of you concedes.
According to the old rules. The new rules, no one concedes.
You really want to lose them all in their first fight?
A brave man never surrenders.
Lucky for you, those weren't the rules when we fought.
You be scored on this, so fight hard. Go!
So amazing.
I know, it's nuts. It could not be anything but the Lord. Like, it's really crazy in retrospect to see his
right.
hand in everything, you know?
Right.
Even when I decided I wasn't going to do the arts anymore, I've always had a heart for,
right.
for artists, for actors, for
mm-hmm.
this industry, you know, to
right.
see it renewed.
Right.
And I don't know. Maybe I'll do cross-cultural ministry as well. Who knows? But for right now, the Lord sort of kicked me right back into the arts. And I'm not complaining. It's very nice.
Yeah. Okay, for our last 10 minutes, let's talk about this. What is God, what do you see God doing in the arts? Do you see him reclaiming it? Because a lot of people will say, you know, you can't really be saved working, you know, in movies because they ask you to do all these things that are ungodlike. Like, what do you say to that? What do you see God doing? How do you see him moving? Mm-hmm. And any of you can just jump in.
Well, I see a lot of, and this is something that I'm part of as well. I travel to other countries because of my experience with my parents. I actually have free airfare anywhere I want to go. So I've actually been utilizing that to travel to other countries
right.
and bring my gift of cinematography and my gift of storytelling to their story.
Wow.
So just a couple months ago, I went to Haiti and I helped build a church there and documented the whole thing. So that the whole world can
mm-hmm.
see the struggle and see the you know, and that's the other thing. See, and when you see, you know, horrible things, you can't look at the horrible thing. You have to look at all the people helping,
mm.
all these people that are there you know, volunteering their time or volunteering all their effort. Mm-hmm. And that's what I showcase. And when I go overseas, like I've been to New Zealand, I've been to Europe, and I've been, and I spent a ton of time in Haiti, months in Haiti, building a documentary that would help show all the positive things that are happening there, and how God is influencing people to, you know, give. At the end of our trip, we all gave our shoes. We boarded the plane without shoes on.
That's so
because
great.
There's so many people there without shoes, you know.
Oh,
and
right.
It's just like, and we gave away our tool belts and everything, and just everything we had, you know, because we can get more of that here.
That's right.
You know, they just don't have the they don't have all the advantages that we do. So, I find that is God taking back the entertainment industry, or is he? Do I see his influence there? Absolutely, 100%.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be able to travel these places and get the opportunities I have.
Wow, that's amazing. What about you guys?
Yeah.
I mean, I think, you know, people are hungry to know the Lord everywhere. And through this particular experience on Divergent, it became so very clear to me that that hunger is so strong in this industry. You know, especially for an actor, it is a career based on validation from other people. People telling you that you're right or you're good.
Right.
And it leads to this sort of desperation, really, to continually have that. And so I think it became more and more clear to me, you know, our predisposition to chase after that fulfillment, that thing that's going to fill that sort of God-shaped hole that Maria was talking about. And I don't know, through this process, my heart just broke for, but I will also say, for those that I was working with, those who are walking through this really difficult industry, not knowing the Lord, I can't imagine, you know?
Right.
And I think also, I've seen God through this process, while I may have walked into it thinking I'm going to be all on my own as a believer, he has continually revealed to me people I had no idea were walking with the Lord. And it's been a huge encouragement, you know, just to see those ambassadors sort of coming out from the woodwork. The author of Divergent is a really solid follower of the Lord. Her books are huge. You know, I can That's amazing. See God reclaiming the arts for his glory. And I think,
you
know, we know from Scripture that God is reclaiming all things for his glory.
Right, of course.
So the arts are no exception. But yeah, I've definitely been encouraged to see more and more people sort of come forward and, you know, to learn that they're walking with
the Lord. I also see that through the storytelling that takes place.
Okay.
I mean, sure, you have direct, you know, movies like Noah and things like that that have come out. But all these stories have such elements, thematic elements.
Of faith
and also very familiar arcs that take place. A lot of people go back to the Bible to find amazing stories of redemption, of faith, of love, of the ultimate sacrifice. I mean, even in such movies like The Matrix that was mentioned earlier. The One.
Yeah, exactly.
Hint.
I always said that. And I just want to say, I just feel like, you know, you can be a missionary to the artists on set. You know, that's been my passion.
We just have a couple of minutes left, but Mimi, I wanted to ask you, how do you walk that line of being a believer, but also not letting, I guess, the secular nature of this job influence you?
It's fellowship. It's fellowship with other like-minded believers. And I've been very involved with, there's a Christian Arts Conference in Chicago every year called Caritas. People could check that out, KARTOS.com. And through that, over 20 years ago, that's where I got my calling to be an actor. That's where I fed. So you network with other believers that could pray for you. So you really, you have to be strong. It's a, it's a tough industry. So you have to be in the Word. You have to be on your knees, you know, praying, because it is, it's the enemy's domain, and he doesn't like it when we're there. I feel like we're on the front lines, because, you know, it's, film is the most influential thing in our culture. So that's why I'm really passionate about using film to share Jesus Christ, whether or not it's in a Christian story or just a, or any kind of story, but that if we're there as ambassadors, you know, we have influence that whoever we meet on set, or, you know, is going to be influenced either one-on-one or it's going to be influenced in the story. So we need to be strong as believers. So that's really my heart's cry to other believers in the industry is to, you have to stay grounded because we are,
that's true,
we're a threat. Right.
Yeah, in the, we have to wrap up. I really appreciate all you guys. I'm sorry, like we just started getting all into this and now, but Vince, will you close us out with your comments and then do a quick prayer for us?
Yeah, I just wanted to add to Mimi's comment. When you ask God for strength, he gives you hardship. Mm. You know, there are things that God doesn't directly give you everything that you want right away, but right. He does hear you, and he works his method to make sure that you get stronger.
Right.
You know, I did some filmmaking with a blacksmith one time, and he told me the strongest piece of steel is the one that gets hammered the most. Mm. And you know, you take a lot of guff in this industry. You know, there's a lot of hardship. I'm so thankful for your blessings and everything. Amy, you've had an amazing path carved out for you. But there are people out there that are just continually struggling. And you know, we have to pray for those people.
Would you lead us in prayer and just close out prayer?
Sure. I'm Roman Catholic, so I do. In the Father,
Son. That's fine.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful opportunity to express and testify that your love and your grace is real and existing in all of us. And thank you for giving us the opportunity to encourage others and to show others that that they too one day can be here and be with us, and it is a welcoming environment. Mm.